Welcome to the library's oral history program. The following interview was conducted with John Christian for the Purdue University Oral History Project. It took place on Tuesday, September 26, 2006, at Dr. Christian's home, 1401 Woodland Avenue. The interviewer is Katherine Markee. Well, can you tell us when and where you were born and a little bit about your parents and siblings?
Sure, I'd be glad to
hear that. And early years in school?
Yes. In Indianapolis. And I resided in Indiana since that time. So I'm a true Hoosier. And my parents lived out close to the Romney area, which is south of Lafayette, about 10 or 12 miles. You may not know where that area is, but they lived, had a farm out there, and I was raised on the farm and went to the local township schools. And then in 1935, I entered Purdue and got a bachelor's science degree in 1939, standard 4 years at that time. And then went to work for the Upjohn Company, a large pharmaceutical manufacturing company in Kalamazoo, Michigan. And I stayed there 1 year, after which I was offered the first Eli Lilly and Company fellowship in medicinal chemistry. And I came back to do graduate work in that area.
Did what high school did you go to? In New Rome?
I went to the local hospital, local school out at West Point, which is a small town, even smaller today than it was then.
Sure.
But the high school was located there in West Point. It's about 10 miles south east of Lafayette.
Do you have any living brothers or sisters?
I had a brother and a sister. They're both deceased.
Now, did you get to, you went to the pharmacy school? You got your 4 year, was that what you were
yes,
in school of pharmacy?
Yes, I got my bachelor of science degree in medicinal chemistry, which was one of the options
in the
that
school.
Time in the school of pharmacy. And it was a combined program with the Department of Chemistry. Medicinal synthesis, organic compounds used for treatment of the medication for diseases.
Right. And then you went to, after high school, and then you came on. Now, when you were in high school, would you belong in any clubs or student organizations, or what was it like? How large was the school?
Well, the school wasn't very large. Our class, only 30 there.
Did you went, you lived at home then while you went to?
Oh yes, yes. Yeah, we transported ourselves in the usual school bus available in those days.
When you were in college, did you live on campus or did you?
I lived at home.
Oh.
Yeah. Because, you see, 1935 was the middle of the Great Depression and there wasn't much money.
What was the campus like in the times when you were here?
Oh, it was very small, you know, less than 3,000 students.
Were there many, mostly, were there very many females, or was it more males?
Not very many, probably one-third at that time. In our class, well, there were 39 in my class in the pharmacy school, and I think there were four girls in that class. So there weren't too many women.
And then you said that you got this fellowship, this Lilly Fellowship.
Yes.
Did you have to take it? Would the fellowship require you to come to Purdue, or did you select Purdue? How did that?
Well, it was granted to Purdue.
Oh, I see.
By
Lilly?
By Eli Lilly, for this special area of medicinal chemistry. And And then Purdue selected myself as the first participant. And there were continuing fellowships along over the years. I don't know whether they still, I don't think they still have the Eli Lilly fellowships.
Was it just one fellow per year?
Just one per year.
And then when you finished that, you just had a bachelor's at the 4 year, they only
in
gave
the 4 year
bachelor's
program, and then the graduate program in medicinal chemistry. I started in that in 1940, and I got my PhD in 1944, all supported by Eli Lilly, which was very important in those days.
That's right.
To get by. And it was a wonderful experience to be working with chemists from Eli Lilly and from the chemistry department at Purdue.
Well, tell us a little bit about something special in the summer that you were doing your research on, or were you took classes during the year?
I was doing research all that period, and I was doing research on new organic compounds for the use as anti-malarials, and that was particularly important there in the early 40s because of our war activities, and we still had a lot of malaria in the armed services, and they were looking for new organic compounds that could be used to treat malaria. And fortunately, I synthesized a series of compounds, but one of those compounds was very active in the preliminary tests of the effectiveness. Actually, it was the most active compound they had. This was in 1942-43. And I got patents on all of that. But then we progressed, and Eli Lilly had a program of studying its effect in humans. Got to that stage. But it was not so effective in humans.
More in animals than
humans. Yeah, more animals.
Okay.
Yeah. But it was an interesting...
It was a good start for you.
Yeah, it was wonderful.
Was Upjohn, were they interested? Were you interested in going back to Upjohn, or after you finished?
Well, no, not really. I was, when I went to Upjohn, I was in their research and analytical division. And I was an analytical chemist. I was analyzing their products and all of the products that went into a new product for their, for their purity. It was more analytical. When I got to Purdue, it was more organic synthesis.
Now I'll turn a little bit, so that now you're back at Purdue and you finished, you got your degree.
Yes.
You're ready to roll, right?
All right.
So I understand in 1950 you were the coordinator of the bionucleonic research. Can you tell us?
Well, yes.
How did you get
I stayed
that?
On at Purdue. After I got my degree,
okay.
I was doing postdoctoral work, supported by more than one pharmaceutical company. And after the first year or so, I got involved in the use of nuclear physics applied to biology, which was a whole new idea that had not been done. And so I started research in that area, and President Hovde, who was president at that time, appointed me as coordinator of bionucleonic research. My job was to assist other divisions and so on at the university in starting new research efforts using nuclear physics as the basis. And that led to appointments.
Well, bionucleonics, can you explain that for people?
Yes, bionucleonics was a term coined by President a radioactive isotope. And then, because you can detect that wherever it goes, we'd follow the organic medicinal into the body, what happened to it, how it's absorbed, excreted, metabolized, learn all about what happens to these organic molecules in the body.
And this was this a brand new area of research?
It was entirely new. The whole area concept was new. And that's why Hovde was interested in seeing it developed in other areas at the university. And because of that, I had many interdisciplinary research projects with engineering, agriculture, sciences, home economics.
Was it a pretty large unit?
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. Involved many different people on campus.
Backing off a little bit, I guess it was in 1947 that Purdue had said some of the research that I have done was the first university in the country to provide formal instruction in the use of radioisotopes.
That was me.
Were you involved in
I taught the first course, mm-hmm. and through this appointment by Hovde, initiated that whole area at Purdue, which then expanded to many other universities.
Okay. By how many students were in it initially?
Well, I remember the first class that I had.
What was the first class?
And the applications of nuclear physics to biology were 37, and they came from all over the campus. Agriculture, engineering, pharmacy, sciences.
These were students that were already here, but they were graduate students?
All graduate students.
Okay.
Yeah.
And they wanted to move in that particular direction.
Yes.
I see.
It was brand new and exciting at the time, you know, of the atomic and hydrogen bomb and development of the production of radioactive materials of all different kinds. Yes. Very exciting period.
When was the bionucleonics department formed? Were you involved in that?
Well, yes.
We had the unit, but that did not become...
Well, the unit was formed around myself. Through this, originally, as coordinator of bionucleonics.
As that
unit.
And
subsequent to that, about 1946, Dean Jenkins, who was Dean of Pharmacy, Nursing, and Health Sciences, started the new department of the control of radioactive isotopes called Health Physics. Safe use of radioactive material. And that department then existed until about 1947 when the bionucleonics department was formed.
Okay. Along with your affiliation, you were married, you have children? And...
Well, I didn't get married until 1948.
Uh-huh.
My future wife came to Purdue as the first social director of the university housed in the Purdue Memorial Union. And my dean, Dean Jenkins, got a little interesting story.
Please.
He was a president of the Purdue University Club. At that time, the faculty had a very strong, called University Club. And he was president. And as one of his new projects, he decided to start a singles club for the university club. And this new lady came in 1947 as social director, and he appointed her as chairperson of the new singles club. Well, as an afterthought, two or three years later, not that long, two or three months later, he decided to appoint me to the committee. And that was intentional, I think. Anyway, that's how I met my wife. Then we were married in 1948.
Okay. Do you have any children?
We have one daughter, Linda, who lives in Houston, Texas.
Any grandchildren?
No grandchildren.
Okay.
And she's married, and...
Did your daughter go to Purdue?
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And what was her major?
Her major was bionucleonics in the bionucleonics department. And then she got a master's degree in industrial management. And then she went to work for Exxon Corporation in Houston, Texas, and had been with them ever since.
Oh, that's a long period of time. She's been quite a while.
Because she's 52 now.
Uh-huh. Okay. Is she also married?
Yes, she's married, but no children.
Okay. Very nice. Can you expand a little bit for our researchers and things about some of the research that you did with your isotopes and radioisotopes, some of the things that you were involved in, and how it may have changed a little bit over time?
Yes. Well, at the beginning, it was quite obvious to the people starting this new area that there are all kinds of possibilities of what we call labeling molecules. And it could be any molecule, but at the beginning we were mostly interested in compounds used in medicine. So for example, and we did this, you could label aspirin with a radioactive carbon atom. Radioactive carbon atom emitted beta rays, which could be detected at a distance with a Geiger-Müller counter. You probably heard of that. But those became very important. So you could label aspirin, and now it's radioactive aspirin, labeled with the carbon atom. And you can administer that radioactive
to a human.
Yes, we did it early in animals, and also in human, and follow what happens to it in the body. And it's interesting, the very first research project was most interesting. It involved the production of what we call an enteric-coated tablet. Enteric-coated tablets were such that they would pass through the stomach without being digested and enter into the intestine, and then they would be disintegrated. Well, the very first experiment, we made radioactive sodium tablets using radioactive sodium, which is also a beta gamma emitter, and that was administered to patients. And because of the radiation, you could follow.
You could see that visibly.
Yeah, you could follow with the Geiger counter right down into the stomach. And then furthermore, you could tell when it moved from the stomach into the intestine. And so it was a means of determining the efficacy of the enteric coat to protect the tablet while it's in the stomach before it went into the intestine.
Before it passed into there.
It's kind of an interesting experiment.
Yes, it is. Where did you get, I'm talking about people, you started, of course, with animals, but did you have, did you do some testing of human subjects here as well? Or
yes.
That must have changed over time.
Well, yes, the rules became more strict, and later on there was a committee again on the use of human subjects in research. Federal government started this program of checking on possible misuse of patients and studying all kinds of things. And so this committee on the use of human subjects, and interestingly enough, I was appointed as the first chairperson that committee. And so we never did too many human projects here, but they were then done by the pharmaceutical companies that were supporting this kind of research.
So you had a lot of external funding?
Yes.
For much of
this,
I see. Okay. I see that has the focus on your research, did it change over time, or are you staying primarily with your radioisotopes, or how did, sometimes
the
focus has changed?
Well, it expanded.
Okay.
areas, as I said, we're working with other divisions of the university, and we work all the way from beef cattle to rats, mice, guinea pigs, many different areas of research. That whole thing that ballooned out to include this technique in all kinds of research, not just limited to medicinal substances. Well, for example, you could just study the toxicity of environmental contaminants. You could label the environmental contaminant, find out what happens to it, where it goes in the body. Does it go to the lung, heart? That no longer medicinal, but it's environmental. So there was a big emphasis on environmental a little later, and that led to the establishment of the Institute for Environmental Health, which I hit it up, that was maybe about 1960.
Is that an institute, is that a national or a...
No, it was an institute located here in Purdue.
Oh, I see.
Supported by the Food and Drug Administration.
I see. Also, in 1979, the Indiana Commission of Higher Education authorized and approved the School of Health Sciences. And then, that was the branch, and you were appointed the head?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Had to been, that brought together the bionucleonics? Or,
yes.
Oh, okay. But before that, it was just what, with pharmacy, and there wasn't a specific school, per se, for health science.
That's right. And that started a whole new approach with broadening of, and the staff was expanded. Everything began to grow pretty rapidly.
Were there, what departments were comprised of that, the school?
Well, all of the divisions of pharmacy, pharmaceutical practice, chemical, organic synthesis, those areas. And then other schools sent their students, graduate students, to learn the techniques, and would go back and use them. And that was part of the bionucleonics.
I see. And then, so Mike, you're talking about in your curriculum, and I guess when it started in 1959, addressed that earlier, we had the curriculum for it, which is really kind of
yes.
Good. And you talked about that Institute of Environmental Health, and I see you were the director. Is it still operational? And you say it's on campus?
Not in the same way.
Okay.
The Institute is no longer being supported, but there is comparable work going on, but under different kind of structure.
Is it still within the School of Health Health Sciences, or is it multidisciplinary?
No, it's beyond that.
Okay. But primarily
but
was with the health science people.
School of Health Sciences got involved early on in what we call health physics. Health physics was a whole new area developed in the 50s, which is the safe use of ionizing radiation, because radioactive materials are hazardous because they're ionized. You have to handle them properly in a safe manner, otherwise you get into trouble. So this whole area of health physics, and that's a major component now in the School of Health Sciences.
Is health, could you elaborate a little bit on health physics? Is that for people that are be working with the materials, and is that...
Yes.
And can they work in a medical environment or...
Medical environment,
industry?
Scientific environment. And it's not limited to radioactive material, because ionizing, there are many other kinds of ionizing radiation. For example, X-rays. The safe use of X-rays came in under that category of health physics. That's a different kind of ionizing radiation.
And they have to be careful when they're, sometimes when I have a dental thing, they step out while they're doing the X-ray. So
that's health physics.
Yes.
safe use of the radiation in medicine.
Sure.
And you have to have that, otherwise people misuse it and people get hurt.
Their problems, that's right, yeah. We talked a little bit earlier about external funding, but were a lot of the isotope studies, were they funded by government and industry? And
industry,
elaborate a little bit on that.
Industry and
how would you go about getting some of the grants?
Well, a good deal of our funding was from the federal government. Because it's a whole new area expanding, there was great need for people trained in that area. And the federal government supported programs of fellowships and assistantships to provide financial means for students,
to come.
Graduate students to come. That still goes on, but it was fairly new to do that in those days. And we had a lot of funding. And at one time, we had in the School of Health Sciences, we had over 55 graduates working.
What particular agencies would have been?
Well, it was the Food and Drug Administration, mainly,
uh-huh.
And other components. At that time, there was a new area developed in the federal government for use of ionizing radiation, and they supported graduates.
And then, so you were head of health science until about 1984, is that right? So how did the department change over time? Did students, I mean, tell us a little bit about the curriculum and some of the students, how did, you know.
Well, the curriculum, of course, advanced many, many new courses. New courses in health physics and industrial hygiene and radioisotope applications. And that then progressed to the point at which, I mean, maybe you haven't there, but to the point at which we started the new School of Health Sciences, 1978, which brought together these various components that I've mentioned and talked about under one umbrella called the School of Health Sciences. That was 1978.
Okay. So it has really grown, but before that it was a little bit different then?
Because there were individual
units within
groups working, right. And they were brought together under the new school. And that new school, now is 25 years old, is part of the School of Pharmacy, Nursing, and Health Sciences. The dean over those three areas.
There's a dean for health sciences as well?
No, it's a department head.
Okay, and then, but there's a dean for the overall?
Overall.
Okay. And you got some appointments. One of the ones that caught my eye was President Reagan appointed you.
Yeah.
How did that come about? And tell us a little bit about your involvement in this and what it entailed. Because you know President Reagan visited here.
President Reagan was very interested way back there in new sources of energy. And now, this is a big thing now, everybody's on the bandwagon. But he had the idea that we ought to, back at that time, be developing new sources of energy, not depending on foreign oil. And he appointed this new committee under himself for the development of ideas for new sources of energy. And that group continued for about 2 years.
What were some of the other, were there other people from Indiana or anybody from Purdue that was on that? Tell us a little bit about what your involvement was.
Well, I was the only one from Purdue, and I don't recall, I don't think there was anyone else from Indiana. It was a broad committee from many different areas.
Academics, industry?
Yes. And I think there are 12 members of that committee representing many different
you get a chance to meet him?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Shook hands, anyway. I never got to be personal friends or anything like that. But I did know him. And he knew me, but maybe not for long. But at any rate, the report was quite inclusive. Had many of the ideas that we're hearing about today back at that time.
That's pretty good for the early 80s.
Yeah.
That was kind of a big thing.
It was an interesting development.
I want to talk a little bit about the students in the schools in mental health sciences. How have they changed in their focus and in the enrollment and your interaction with the students?
Well,
faculty advisor for any of them? Or?
Am I faculty?
Were you a faculty advisor for some of the clubs?
Yeah. Uh-huh. In fact, it's all of the faculty in the school of health sciences. And before that, in the other divisions, I had graduate students. And that was our main thrust, was the training of new graduate students. And we were not teaching, this component was not teaching undergraduates at that time. But now, there are a number of courses being taught graduates that go into various areas, industrial hygiene, into health physics, hospital work, nuclear pharmacy, that whole area.
Okay.
Run out of a battery?
Okay. Yeah, no, we still got this one going, so that's okay. More time. Is that going to be okay for you?
Whatever. Yes, I'm.
I think. And we'll go ahead. And then we'll wait until 3, and then we should be okay on this. Let's see. So we're talking about the students, but on that another appointment I see that you've got was the December 9th, the Medical Advisory Committee for Health Education and Welfare.
That's the Department of Health Education and Welfare.
Tell us a little bit about that particular one.
Well, there again, because of my early interest in the development of this whole area of health physics, application of radioactive material, safety, and all that, I was appointed to that advisory committee. And I spent, I don't know, 4 or 5 years on that committee.
What did, can you tell us a little bit about what your work involved?
Well,
meetings,
it involved advising the group on the use of these materials in health and welfare. New idea. We're looking for new ideas, new developments.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's kind of, do they still have that sort of committee, do you know?
I don't think so, but I'm not sure. They probably have a dozen others associated.
There's so many committees.
Yeah.
When in doubt, what did they say, form
right.
A committee? Were there any other government appointees that were involved in, that you want to comment on, that you
were
involved in?
Well, I was active for years in the state of Indiana, radiological. Okay. Control committee.
Tell us a little bit about that. Was that statewide?
Yeah, statewide, appointed by the governor to control radioactive material in the state and to provide ideas of how to handle emergencies. Radioactive release of radioactive material. We're still concerned. We're still concerned about that because of the possibility of radioactive bombs put off that have radioactive materials in them at high enough level that it can damage biological systems. So their development of new rules and regulations control that and to know what to do in
we ever had any?
No, there'd been no major, fortunately, no major accident. There has been some minor cases in where radioactive material was released or lost. For example, radioactive materials are used in the treatment of cancer. They use a radioactive needle, insert into the cancer, and the radiation destroys local tissue. Well, sometimes those got lost, and they're high enough.
In the you're talking about lost in.
Lost, yeah, the hospital.
Facility.
Yes, and so it became important to find those because they're very toxic. If somebody gets a hold of it, put it in their pocket, and carry it around, it can be very destructive. So you have to immediately find it. And that's happened maybe four or five times over the last.
Do you find with the changes that there's more training sessions, more training for people today?
Yes.
Not continuing, whereas maybe in the 70s this was not the case when you first got started?
It wasn't recognized as being so important as
that
it is.
Training or continuing or
yes.
Recertification is another thing too,
right.
The continuing education. Okay, a couple more things, and then we'll do the next time. I know that you are the fourth recipient of the Frederick L. Hovde Outstanding Faculty Fellow Award. You got that. And how did that come about? You were the fourth one. That's very nice.
Well.
Were you a fact fellow as well?
Oh, yes.
Uh-huh.
Back in the middle 70s, probably 1975, President Hovde had the idea that it was important provide students with the opportunity to meet faculty on an informal basis outside the classroom, bring about that relationship. So he initiated the faculty fellow program, in which he appointed into each of the residence halls one of the faculty as the faculty fellow for that hall.
For the residence hall. Those are big buildings.
The residence hall. And then that faculty person recommended others to work with him so that in each hall there was a group of a senior faculty fellow plus others who worked with him to bring about programs within the residence hall to interact with students. And as a result of that, the faculty fellows would come up with programs that would attract students. For example, one of the strong programs was to invite students into the faculty's home. The students liked that. They'd like to be able to come in and see how the faculty live.
And, the other side, right?
So that was done. It's still being done. I still have groups here. In fact, I think it's October 21st. I have a group of 45 students from Owen Hall coming here. We'll get to meet them and lecture to them.
Are you still a fact fellow?
No longer. Last December, I terminated because I no longer walk the steps.
What residence hall? Were you the same one all these years? Or?
No, I started out, name escapes me. It's the farthest one down in the...
Would that be McCutcheon?
McCutcheon. Yeah, that's where I started. You're very good. And I was senior faculty fellow there. I started that program, and then President Hovde asked me to take over the program at Owen Hall. And that was about 4 years later. And I stayed with Owen Hall until last December.
That's very good. That's a nice, it's a good program. And you've seen changes over time with it. Yeah. And you have the students.
35 or 40 years as a faculty person.
That's very And the program is still going.
It's still going, and the faculty fellows go to the hall once a week and eat with students, different students at different times.
Right.
So the students get to know faculty on on their level, not in the classroom.
And it was nice to have some special programs for them, because I know sometimes the athletics Tiller goes around and visits as well, and it gives them a little bit of, and they can sometimes meet in the dining hall, or, you know, it's sort of nice.
Yes,
really.
Yeah.
And, of course, now they have not as many, many of the residence halls don't have the eating facilities, they have the fort.
They go with the students, and move with the students to different food facilities.
That's good.
Yeah. Oh, that's an excellent program.
Yeah. A couple things. You were also the recipient of the Leather Medal.
Yes.
Do you remember that? What sort of medal was that? It's kind of an interesting
name.
Did you get a leather piece of leather?
And it's on display there in the Union Building across from the main desk.
Oh, there's a plaque in there.
A plaque every year.
Oh, okay. Oh, they add to it. So it's one of the ones that they have on the wall.
And
I'll look at that.
Recipient and leather medal, the leather plaque, part of the big one.
Okay.
And with the name of recipient for that year.
Uh-huh.
And it is given to the individual who, in the minds of the students, contributed most to the university for that year.
Very nice.
Nice honor.
Yes, it is. Yes. I think we talked a little bit about the students in the pharmacy school, but how have they gone into outreach? How have some of their focuses changed over time since you've been there as a retiree as well?
Pharmacy has changed quite a bit in terms of originally, in my early days, it was more compounding. You actually made pill tablets, incorporated the ingredients. And that's very seldom done anymore, because that is done by the pharmaceutical company, under strict control. And although the pharmacist theoretically can compound for a very special kind of medication prescribed by a physician, which is very rare, it's not done. All of this is done in the pharmaceutical manufacturing company, like Eli Lilly.
You could elaborate on that. That must be a change. They used to do compounding
very little compounding. But now it's a matter of the pharmacist becoming aware of the nature of the pharmaceutical, the chemical nature, and its interaction with substances in the body and with one another. You can have one medicinal being antagonistic toward a second individual drug, and they interact and cause bad complications. Well, the pharmacist is now the expert, and they evaluate what we call incompatibilities, the incompatibility of two or more pharmaceuticals.
I see. Okay.
And that plus as a advisor, more of an advisor to the physician.
Is that in hospitals and in the drugstores?
Yes.
In the drugstores as well?
Yes.
Okay.
And, of course, there are now a long, very strong area of hospital pharmacy, where the pharmacists are located in the hospital and consult with the physician.
Were they not in the hospital per se?
Not so much.
Oh.
They were.
Where would they get the drugs? They would have to order from a local pharmacist? Or
mm-hmm.
I see. But now they have their pharmacy right inside the hospital.
And then, as a result of our early work with radioactive material, in the School of Pharmacy, they developed a program of nuclear pharmacy. The pharmacist becomes responsible for the production of radioactive pharmaceuticals, which are administered to the body for a variety of purposes. The most common one you may be familiar with use of radioactive iodine to treat the thyroid gland. And the pharmacist prepares that compound, that mixture, for the patient.
Okay. And that's administered from the pharmacist?
Yes.
Is that
so that's all pretty new.
Uh-huh. Okay. All righty. I think from that we'll stop. That's okay.